All right, Heather, these are my favorite stories because I'm always impressed with how someone makes such a huge transition into franchising. So as simple as this question is, it's really, really tough. But how did you accidentally fall into franchising? What's your franchise backstory?
Oh, my franchise backstory is I had been working in healthcare for a long time, specifically in hospice for a long time. And I also had a clinical background as a music therapist and a master's degree in counseling. And I also had a very small private practice. And some family members had been really trying to get me to go into business with them for a long time and pitching different ideas, and finally pitched the idea of a home care agency. And having worked in hospice for so long, I was like, yes, that just really resonated with me. My entire wheelhouse is taking care of people in their homes. That's like all I know how to do. And was very excited about the idea of bringing in the people who really do the biggest part of the work, right? The hands-on direct care staff in the field, and began the process at looking at home care specifically within all of the options in franchising, right? I was only looking at home care, but really did have to make that decision between, are we going to do an independent? Are we going to do a franchise? Are we going to do a greenfield? Are we going to acquire an existing? And thinking through all of those different considerations really landed on franchising as the right fit for us. The support, the community, owning a business can be a very lonely endeavor. So having that sense of the community and having those resources at hand seemed like the best fit for me personally as a very collaborative person by nature. And so kind of went from there and started figuring out which of the franchises would be the best fit for us. And here we are.
Love it. Lots that I want to unpack from that.
Yeah.
So we're going to start with the end part. So you decide franchising isn't of interest. You stick very specific to right at home and brands that are in the same competitor set. Did you go outside of the competitor set and say, you know, not as broad as saying, I want to own a burger franchise, but did you divert at all during your process, or how did that look?
We did stay very much within, pretty exclusively within the scope of home care. There was a little bit of vetting of some of the platforms that are more placement agency platforms, so not true apples to apples competitors there. But we were very much sticking with, once we made the decision that that a franchise was the route to go, the first thing was learning that there's a difference between placement and a fully licensed agency, and then vetting the agencies from there. And it was really a twofold vetting process. One, looking at culture, starting with what the mission statement was of the different franchise systems, and then looking at their support, their culture, their community, and then the other, looking at the financials. What was the buy-in? What was the expectation, the minimums? What was the support? What's the overall health of the franchise system? And from there, we ended up with a pretty short list of three or four different franchise groups. And then from there, we were really focused on acquiring an existing business, so doing a resale. That was the best fit for me, especially as the one who was going to be the operating principal and has since then been the operating principal and had four young kids at home. So doing a greenfield just seemed like an unreasonable lift and would have taken too much of my focus off of my number one priority, which is my kids. So
you're going through this process, and resales can be complex, going back to your mission and vision, because And sometimes they're beautiful. Maybe, you know, there's the exit, in my opinion, is the most beautiful thing of a franchise, owning a franchise, because especially if you've built it up to something that now has built wealth for you and your family, and you're able to say, okay, now I'm going to hand this off to the next buyer, and I'm able to take some chips off the table in that process. But in some cases, when you're going through a resale, you could be buying a unit that has a little bit of turbulence, and you're stepping into it. And you're trying to figure out, like, how do I put my touch on it to now make it really, really stable? When you're going through that and you're really holding true, like you said, the mission is so important to this process. How are you carrying that through on your due diligence of going through the process of buying a resale?
Honestly, it went very poorly is how we did it. And, you know, and especially with, you know, our resale was in 2012, closing in end of Q1 2013. The whole resale process was not what it is today, right? It just wasn't as established yet. There hadn't been franchises in place or a volume of franchises in place. The franchisors had not figured out how to support people through that. The first handful of years that I was in the system, I feel like I kind of became the go-to person for potential new franchisees who were doing resales to talk to about what I would have done differently, right? It all obviously has worked out really, really well in the long run, but there was just so much. It was the unknown unknowns, right? There's just so much that I didn't know. And at that time, resales were few and far between enough that the franchisor wasn't really well positioned to help either. What I see now when I talk to fellow Right at Home owners who did a resale is it's a much more robust process, both with the franchise helping the existing franchisee who's preparing to sell, as well as helping the new owner make sure that they really understand what they're buying.
Totally. So you think about the two brands, you got three to the finish line, you pick Right at Home, two brands that you rejected or didn't match. Was there a single moment in the end that you're like, that just doesn't sit well with me, that elevated your guard to say no? Or how did you come to the decision to say no to the other two?
Well, one was never, there was never a resale that was an option, right? There were a few other resales that did come up with other franchises that we had already looked at and rejected. So we didn't even consider those. And of the two resales that we looked at, the first one, sort of to your previous question, when we started getting into, you know, the NDAs were signed and we started getting into the particulars of the business, there were some red flags pretty early on with the financials that we were able to see that made it a deal breaker, which, you know, in no way, in no meaningful way is a reflection on that franchise system. That was the individual operator and their internal practices. And there's only so much a franchisor should be able to do and say about that, right? We are independent business owners, right? With the support and the brand and the best practices from the franchise. So the next one that we were very fortunate that came up was the other franchise, one of the other franchises on our list, which was Right at Home. And here we are today.
That's so awesome.
Yeah.
Out of curiosity, going, stretching into the personal side, because obviously like whenever you or I make the decision to go into business, there's a greater purpose. Now, obviously there's the purpose of the difference we can make in our customers' lives, obviously is a driving factor. And then the financial side of what it could mean for our families. And as you're growing and building your family, like how much is your like personal drive shifting to like, okay, I'm going to build something for my kids? Or where does your personal, like what the outcome is that you want, where is that at? And how does that relate to obviously the passion of giving a very needed service back to a customer base?
Yeah, that's a good question. I don't think I've ever really thought about it in those terms. I am certainly incredibly grateful for what owning a business and being part of a franchise system has done for my personal family in terms of our financial security and opportunities and all of that. My focus was more how do I stay in terms of my family. My focus, especially initially, my youngest was two, was how do I stay primarily mom, right? Mom first. And I think what really worked for me and drove continues to drive everything for me is staying so focused on vision, mission, and values. If we just do the right thing, if we're focused on taking amazing care of our people, which includes our staff, right? The whole Stephen Covey approach of treating your employees the same way you want them to treat your best customer, then everything else will follow, right? So I've just always stayed really laser focused on that, leading from mission, vision, and values. And the rest follows.
How old are your kids now?
21, 18, 15, and 13.
Wow, that's a handful. Do they? And I'm intrigued by this because I think of the statement that you just said. Like it was important to you to as a having a 2-year-old to be mom first. When you're now that they are aging into maturity of understanding, probably a little bit even more on how the construct the business works. Do they see mom as an entrepreneur, as a business owner? Has that shift happened? And they're like, wow, that's pretty crazy that you did that and you've been successful at it.
Yeah, I don't think I think they probably need to be in their 30s before we get fully to that to that perspective. Just thinking of my own, like realizing that my parents were something more than just my parents' journey, right? I think that's a little they're still a little young for that. I will say though, there was a such a cool moment when my daughter, who is now 18, was in, I don't know, third or fourth grade, I think, and there was a career day. And she, asked me if she could borrow my pearl necklace, and she was doing this, that, and the other. And I was like, oh, Nora, she looked very dressed up and formal. I was like, oh, Nora, are you a teacher? Or, just thinking about things that she had expressed interest in. And she was like, no, I'm a female business owner. So I was like, okay. All right, there's some message
Really cool.
that's getting through there. So yeah, that was a really cool moment.
Well, the truth is in this life that we live, if we've made the decision to be a business owner, and I think it's important to have that North Star of I'm mom first, and then showing the kids what hard work and work ethic and how you treat people, like what this all could potentially equal, whether they choose to go into business for themselves later on in life or not. Like it's such a powerful thing because for us as parents, like we have that North Star of this is still for our family. Like we are going to take care of everything and make sure that we enjoy what we do, but it's for the bigger picture of our family. And so I think it's interesting to hear this because whenever I've talked with a franchisee, like, and everything you're saying aligns to their buying process. It goes, what's the culture? Now let's look at the business model. It's always culture first, because being in business can be lonely. And what's the support structure around me? And
Oh,
how much
definitely.
do they actually care about our customers to make sure that this is actually going to grow? Which, if you really dive into the numbers, if you look at in item 19 in a franchise disclosure document, like the story that it tells is not just the financial side, it's also the culture side of is the culture built on franchisee success? And then if you really dive into why we do this, it's because of family. And so you've touched on each of those areas as you go through this. If you reflect back to 2012, are there things that just blow your mind that you battled through and you're like, wow, I like almost had to have blinders on to go through it.
Yeah, when people will ask the question, if you had to do it over again, would you do it? And I just always laugh, and I'm like, it depends on the day, right? Because so much of what got me through was was the naivete coming into it, and then the work ethic, the hunger, the curiosity. I went and got an MBA because I was tired of not knowing the right questions to ask, right? So all of those driving factors have helped get me to where I am today and to battle through that learning curve and buying an existing business. No matter how robust and wonderful that business is, there's going to be an element of tearing it down to the foundation, shoring up that foundation to be your foundation and rebuilding it, right? So that's just something that people, I tell people who are looking at resales that they should expect, that there's going to be an element of that. Maybe not as dramatic as tearing it all the way down to the foundation, but having that that drive, that passion for the industry that you have chosen, for the brand that you're now a part of, those are all necessary conditions that just have to be in place to get you through the struggle of finding your path and getting through those hard days.
I think about the staff and what's sticking with me, as you said, and obviously you're referencing Stephen Covey, that the treat your staff the way that you want them to treat your customer. In the category that you're in, and you talked about before you got into this, you were connected to hospice. I mean, this is a very, it's a tough, not industry per se, but it's a tough emotional thing to handle, which if we look at the turnover of caregivers, it ends up being tremendous, especially for those that don't treat their teams the way that they want them to treat their customers. Did you find early on that obviously you can't control turnover 100% because it is such a heavy thing on people? And frankly, a lot of people that go through caregiving in some sense end up saying, "Ooh, I would like to own this business too." And they grow into become you. But has some of those lessons of how we treat our staff, has that helped you build a community around you that is a little bit more stable than, say, someone that doesn't treat their staff well?
I would think so, right? And looking at our numbers in terms of average length of service and even our retention rates are substantially better than the industry. But yeah, that was the very first thing that I observed and made a very focused change on when I acquired my franchise location was switching the script about how we spoke to and treated and interacted with our field staff. They are right at home, right? Like I'm Oz, right? I'm just somebody behind the curtain moving levers. Our caregivers are our hands. They are right at home. And so making sure that we're setting them up for success, that they feel prepared, that they feel well trained, that they feel respected and heard, and you know, being a mom, maybe even a little loved, right? About their by their employer is just critical. And if they you know, are just doing caregiving as a stopgap or something to get experience while they're going to school for maybe a healthcare related degree or maybe something totally different, and they're only planning on being here for a short period of time, or if they are a lifelong caregiver, mm-hmm. that this is the place that they want to work because this is the place where they are valued and they are taken care of. I know I was really frustrated early on because I started trying to put all these benefits in place for folks, which I feel like the industry is starting to go in that direction of really making benefits available even for this somewhat transient workforce. And I had this moment of feeling really frustrated because I wasn't seeing a lot of participation in the benefits that we were offering, and I wasn't seeing an impact on our retention rates. And then I just kind of had that aha moment going back to mission, vision, and values. Like, I'm doing this because it's the right thing to do, to take care of my people so they can take great care of my clients. So if we get some quantifiable benefit from it, wonderful. If we don't, I've still done the right thing. So
I think you're statement, and this is obviously it swings into the human side of being a business owner. You said, you know, our staff sometimes needs a mom too. Like, and the reality is like the caregiver needs a caregiver because of how deep it is. And when you carry that mentality back to them and you give them that same, not exact same caregiving, but you give it the empathy and the support, because this isn't an easy business. It is a hard business for them. And then for you as the business operator, you're obviously in the business of carrying through your culture and making sure that it makes sense for them. And I think that's the magic piece here, is the way that you're approaching it probably makes it a little bit more comfortable for them to feel like they're a part of a culture and that you have their back, and they have a shoulder to cry on when they need someone to be there for them too, you know?
Yeah, that's definitely the hope. I know working in hospice, I worked for, you know, a handful of different companies during my hospice years, and hospice is very vocational, right? Which caregiving is too, but in a different way. But with hospice, you're either a hospice person or you're not, right? And the different companies that I worked for during that time, it was really such a stark difference in how they supported and took care of their field staff, right? And so really carrying that lesson over to here. If you are vocationally a caregiver or not, if you are working someplace where you feel valued and heard and supported and you're making a good wage, and you have access to benefits and there's an opportunity to raise yourself and your family up, that's what all of us want in our work, right? Is to have meaning and success and comfort and security. So yeah, it's just critical to make sure that we're supported, that we're doing that. Because yes, the work is the work, no matter if you're working for my Right at Home office or you know, Heather's home care down the street. The work is the work, but how are you as an employee supported and prepared and trained and cared for through that work? It's a huge differentiator.
When you reflect back on your career, do you feel like you were born for this?
Oh yeah. Yeah, absolutely. I like to tell the story of having all four of my grandparents, five of my great grandparents, many of their siblings, and the like, when I was a young child, and the last of the great grandparents' generation, I was 20 when they passed away. Wow. And the last of my grandparents, you know, just a handful of years ago, I'm 50 now. So that tree was really full as a young person, and grew up watching people age and how they faced aging and how the other family members cared for the aging population, their parents and grandparents. So yeah, kind of, I like to joke that I really didn't have any choice. I was destined to work in this industry.
As deeply personal of a question this may sound, so you watched your great grandparents and your grandparents age all the way through death. And at the same time, 2012 to now, that's 12 years of transformation in an industry that was really not defined or not around, called pre 2010, 2008. So like, does it make you, as weird as this is, more comfortable with the aging process, knowing that all this infrastructure has been built around our communities, that, you know, like when you and I are at the place of needing this care, like it should be as superior as can be, whereas our grandparents or great grandparents may have not had the same situation that we're going to have.
Right, right. Yeah. Well, I mean, it's been such an interesting, if you take a really long view, right, it's been such an interesting just cultural shift, right? Because for my great grandparents, it was just expected that they took care of their parents and grandparents, and everybody tended to live a little bit closer together. And there was more of a sense of community, and all of that was, our lives were a little bit more insular, for better and worse, right? 100 years ago, 150 years ago, and then just the great arc of technology and mobility and transportation and all of that gave us more opportunities, smaller families, and so things have changed. And yeah, certainly in the last quarter, last third of the 20th century, there was maybe not as good of support and infrastructure. And there certainly is a lot more of it now. And yes, I'm very hopeful for the future, excited about what's going on. I do worry that our healthcare system is too fragmented, and maybe even a bit of a house of cards. And there's definitely a lot of opportunity for improvement in how all of that functions. But the knowledge is there and the resources are there. If we can just figure out how to collaborate better as a healthcare system, there's great, great opportunity for taking impeccable care of people with dignity and autonomy through their last breath.
Well, I think that last statement on the healthcare system, like the reality is, again, like senior care as it exists today was not, we go back, I'm saying 2008, I would say 2005, it doesn't really exist as a franchise company. And now tons and tons of franchise and business owners exist in this category to help make some of this transformational change that maybe it's going to happen in the healthcare industry too. Like the beauty of franchising is when you allow people to access it as a business opportunity and you allow smart people to get into it, then the collective ends up having impact of transformation of an industry. And there's obviously other things that we need to continue to work at fixing as a community. And when business attaches to those, then sometimes that accelerates it. So we'll see what happens
right,
there.
Right. Hope springs eternal.
Last question I want to ask you.
Yeah.
Dreams, curiosity, Where do you go from here on out with your business?
Oh, dreams. Well, I one of the big concerns that I have about the industry, that I've always had about the industry, is there is support and options in place for people to get the care that they need who are indigent, who have nothing, right? And there are people who have invested wisely and saved well and gotten their long-term care insurance policies and are just wealthy, who can afford whatever they need. But there's this great middle that can't access it, don't qualify for third-party payers, can access home care, but not to a sufficient level to really meet their needs. And so there's a need there, a desperate need there with our aging population, which is a tremendous opportunity, but we have to figure out how to care for all of those folks, how to get them access to services. I'm really excited about some of the proposals that I'm hearing this election cycle. There's a lot of opportunity there to serve more people. And also with how crowded the field is with home care, with franchises, with independents, we're really primed for some consolidation as well. And it's probably even overdue at this point. So lots of opportunity there. And it's really exciting. It's exciting to think about being able to serve exponentially more seniors and help them age on their terms with their autonomy intact and with dignity as they define it. So I'm very, very excited about the opportunities that are coming up in that area.
Well, I've loved every part of our conversation, but this last statement, like, and I read faces. And so the excitement that you have now 12, 13 years later to still be, I'm in it. I am curious. I'm excited about this. I want to continue to have impact. Like that to me, we were having this conversation about you owning your burger restaurant. And if you had that same energy, I'd be like, well, that's amazing. You still want to serve burgers after all this time. But I think that's the cool part about this is that There is a scare of the burnout factor when you go into business by yourself, but when you have support and infrastructure to at least cover some of the basics that you're going to need to now get beyond 10 years and still want to do it, like that's a pretty cool thing that that I'm excited to see that you're in that mental space too. Like that is awesome.
Yeah. Well, I've got more work to do. I have more things to accomplish. So time to get to it.
Love it. Well, Heather, I'm grateful for this conversation. It was awesome. Thank you for doing it.
Thank you so much. Heather, it's been great.
For Heather, I'm Nick. This is another episode of Meet the Z.